So one of the things that we wanted to focus on during this presentation is how graduate level writing really does differ from the writing that you very likely did as an undergraduate. And Tom mentioned that earlier. And one of the big differences is that you will be writing very large scale research papers as a graduate student. And they generally contain the different sections that are listed on your screen there. An abstract, an introduction, you have a lit review, methodology, findings, results, discussion, and conclusion. These are things you might have never written before as an undergraduate, and that's perfectly fine. Hopefully some of what our presentation today will do is give you a sense of what these things are. Slide. Thank you. So the first one we want to talk about is the abstract. It appears at the very beginning of the paper, and you've probably seen these if you've looked at any journal articles when you did research as an undergraduate, but the abstract is what appears first, and it's often, if someone else is doing research, it's what they see and read first and skim through to see if they want to use the research that you've done. The abstract is kind of a big picture. It explains the main purpose of your research. It establishes the wider context and kind of creates the niche that your research is filling. It highlights how it's contributing to the field, whatever field you're entering. It does outline your methodologies and your findings. It provides an answer to the so what question. And like Amy mentioned, it's really important to keep demonstrating, why is all of this relevant, what I'm doing here? Why should you care as a reader? And the big thing about abstracts, you really need to keep them short, usually no longer than 200 words. And short, concise writing can be challenging. We have a whole Writing Center workshop on writing scientific abstracts because they can be tough. Okay, next up. Introductions. So, you know, undergrad papers, you probably had some form of an introduction. You're gonna have a purpose statement. What are you doing here? You are always going to be addressing some sort of research question. What question is your research answering? And we're going to talk a little bit more in depth about research questions a bit later. You're still going to have a thesis. That's the main point of the paper, whatever you're writing. Demonstrating the importance, the relevance, the so what. Provide any context or background that is necessary for your reader to understand what you're talking about. And it does, you know, your intro provides a roadmap for the entirety of your paper. Now, Amy is going to talk a little bit more, in a little bit more depth about what you might do with the introduction.
I'm going to chime back in a little bit to introduce what could be a useful model for you to consider when you're making your introductions. This is called the CARS model, or creating a research space. So when we first open our introduction, so readers are trusting us to kind of be experts in the area we're talking about, that we've done all of our reading, we've done our homework. So our first job is to provide context. So your first move is to establish a claim of centrality. Show why your topic matters to many people. You make some general topic generalizations to kind of bring the readers in, to give them the context necessary to understand what you're going to be talking about. And you also review relevant pieces of previous research to show how your ideas will relate to others that are already in the academic or industry conversation. After you establish your territory, it's time to carve out a niche or a gap that you will then fill. So to establish a niche, you can do a couple different things. You can either make a counterclaim. Maybe research has said A, but you're like, ah, but B could also be helpful. The second thing you can do is to indicate a gap, where you can say, okay, so we know this, like, this educational technique works really well in colleges, but does the same research technique work with high school students or middle school students? So you can indicate that there's a gap, something missing in the information, or you can take a topic and raise a question about it to further extend research and ideas that the field is already working with. After you establish your niche, then you have to occupy the niche, or you have to fill the gap. So you have to show how your study will solve or bridge or further contribute to the gap or the niche that you identified. So you do that by either outlining your purposes, or you can announce some preliminary results, or you indicate how your study will fill the gap that you have identified. And this is called creating a research space. Let me give you one example to maybe help illustrate this, admittedly, a little bit of an abstract point. So I will read this. So research has shown that teachers who are enthusiastic and who report high self-efficacy often have highly motivated students. So we look at this first sentence. This is their claim of centrality or their general context. So they're saying that there's been previous research, and then they list the authors, that teachers who are enthusiastic and kind of believe in themselves often have really highly motivated students, and that's our topic. The next sentence begins with a however, which kind of like reverses our expectations. However, little is known about the underlying mechanisms through which teacher enthusiasm and self-efficacy relate to student motivation. So the next sentence is like this like surprising point. So although this is important, they're saying that little is known about this relationship. So given the consistent decline in adolescent motivation, there is a need to examine how teachers who are enthusiastic and efficacious successfully motivate their students. So this next sentence, its job clearly illustrates a need, a gap. There is a need to examine because of this recent decline. And we know enthusiastic teachers and good student results are often linked. So the last sentence shows how the gap or the niche will be filled. The purpose of this study was to examine whether the enthusiasm in the classroom management, and then the paper will go on to show how it does this. But in the first four sentences, we have identified, created, and filled the research. So this is one technique that you can use during your writing. So I'm now going to pass it back to Michelle.
Okay, so we're going to move back to talking about the parts of a graduate level research paper. We started with abstract, moved along to introduction, and now we're going to talk about the literature review. There are lots of lit reviews that are done in graduate school and lots of lit reviews that are done in professional publications, which you'll see as you start to look at more and more of those articles. And the lit review is pretty much where you are providing a big picture overview of the information that is already professionally out there that's related to your topic. And it's showing, you know, I've done my research, I am well versed on the topic at hand that I am discussing. So within a lit review, you still want to have kind of like a mini paper in there where you have an intro, a quick idea of the topic of the lit review, such as a theme. You want to have a body. This is where you discuss all of your sources. There are different organizational methods you can follow for lit reviews, which we're not going to do a deep dive into today just because of time purposes. And then draw some conclusions. What have you drawn from reviewing the lit so far, and where might the discussion proceed from there? So, as you can see from the big caution sign on the screen, there is one very specific area where many students kind of stumble when writing lit reviews, especially if they haven't done it before. And that's with understanding the difference between synthesis and summary. So, if you go to the next screen, Amy, I'm just going to talk a little bit about these. Summary is really when you just summarize each piece of literature that you've looked at bit by bit and move along that way. A synthesis is where you're really weaving all of the different resources that you have looked at together and talking about how they work together. A lit review has to synthesize, not summarize. So really, like it says on the screen, the most common issue with lit reviews is that they simply summarize. Piece A said this, piece B said this, piece C said this, etc. That's not how you're supposed to do a lit review. Everything really needs to be woven together, showing how all of the existing literature works and kind of speaks to one another. Back to Amy for a moment with a tool.
Yeah, I'm gonna, a little tool to share with you. This is This is something I would recommend that you start from your very first class. So these are sometimes called graphic organizers, reading organizers. But really what they are is either a Google Sheet or an Excel document where you take notes. So if you look at my example here, each different row is a different article I have read, and each column is something that I was going to be tracking. So let me give you a little close-up here. If we look at my article number 2, you can see that I take various notes. If I make a quote, I put it in quotation marks, and I write down the page numbers so I can find and remember what I have read. In undergraduate papers, maybe you had to read 2 or 3 or 4 papers per project, but here you might have to read 10, 20, 30, 40 if you're working on your thesis statement or your dissertation or master's level thesis. So it does take time to make more intricate notes, but when your project will span weeks or semesters, doing this is one easy way to find information, because if you look here, like everything in red is was a certain topic about identity I was tracking, and all the blue is also related. So I can look by color. I can also click Control Find and look for certain authors or certain terminology points. So I would recommend that you keep a record that has an interface like an Excel document for your research, because at the end of your time, not only will you be able to write papers better, but you'll be able to quickly access it once you're still in your job. Knowledge will be yours forever. And that's the end of our little tool tip. I'm going to pass it back to Michelle.
A next section of the paper, after you've done abstract, intro, lit review, methodology. This is where you go through the methods of your research, what you did in your research project. You should really detail all the steps of them with the accompanying rationale. So not just I did X, Y, Z like a laundry list, but I did X because blah, blah, blah. And then outline that. They should be presented, of course, in logical order, chronological order, if the steps are important, if the time process is important. After methodology, you want to present what you found. So after you did your research, what were the results? You want to be specific about the findings that you discovered. You want to summarize all of them, again, presenting them in logical order. You can include headings and subheadings to kind of organize what you discovered along the way. Discussion. This is really one of the most important parts of a grad research paper, because this is where you kind of do some analysis. You address your research question with reference to the results from your research. You put your findings in context and you interpret your findings. So you are offering your interpretation of what you discovered. You do want to address the limitations of your research. This is super important in grad school, and I have encountered students who don't want to do this because they think if they acknowledge a limitation, it means that their research was unsuccessful or was bad, which is not true. Every piece of research is going to have some sort of a limitation to it. Maybe your research involved a fairly small sample size. That would be a limitation that you would want to address and discuss. You're demonstrating the significance of your findings, new insights, and you're really proving your expertise on the topic. And that's where, you know, you are showing you have synthesized the literature on the topic. You have critically analyzed your own research as you've moved forward. And lastly, conclusion. Again, you probably wrote conclusions in undergraduate papers. In grad papers, you are providing some summary, but not a simple restatement of everything you've done. The last two bullets are the most important. What are the implications of the research that you've done? So you've done this big study, what are the implications? And kind of addressing that now what question that Amy mentioned at the beginning, what are some areas for future research? So now that you've done this, what can be done more to move forward? So again, there's just the list, the parts of the research paper. So you'll have these slides in the future, kind of keep these sections in mind generally when you're writing grad